All right, well, first of all, good afternoon, and thanks for this opportunity to celebrate the 30 years of Desert Shield, Desert Storm. I'm Command Sergeant Major retired, McKinley Curtis III. At the time of doing Desert Shield, I was a first sergeant in the 50th Signal Battalion airborne at Fort Bragg. I deployed to Saudi Arabia early in September and stayed September of 90 and stayed there until 91. We did a lot of training. Part of being my job as a first sergeant, I had over 200 plus soldiers up underneath me. We first arrived, we were in a place called Cement City. And then we separated from there and went to different parts of the area in Saudi Arabia. Of course, very hot when we got off there, flew commercial going over and commercial coming back. But again, it was interesting. One of the things I think that was interesting when we got there is I believe that the Japanese were on our side by providing utility of vehicles. So if you can imagine commanders riding in Lexuses, cruisers, the whole nine yards, you know, if you were of higher rank, you had a nice vehicle to ride in. And so again, the logistics of doing Desert Shield, Desert Storm were unique. Me being part of the 18th Airborne Corps, I supported at the time General Luck, who was the 18th Airborne Corps commander. And we moved about in various locations. When I say logistics, one of the things that somewhat resonates in my mind is being able to have the luxury of having a hot meal every day. That actually didn't happen until later on in the war, where we finally had reefer vans full of food delivered to us. I also had the opportunity to be in two battalions, believe it or not. I started out in the 50th Signal Battalion, then I went over to the 426 that was not airborne, where I had to somewhat relieve someone who had lost their weapon, and they needed another first sergeant to take that spot. As I told many people, at the time we were in Desert Shield, Desert Storm, a lot of people thought there was going to be huge casualties on the American side, so we were plussed up with military personnel. That's why I was able to go from one company to another company, although my commander didn't like it, but it all worked out in the good. I ended up going in the middle of the desert, believe it or not, where the mortuary affairs was set up. And I had to deal with, you might say, different mindset of going from, you might say, the airborne world to a non-airborne world, working with different individuals that was part still of the brigade. But again, within the 18th Airborne Corps, you had two battalions that were airborne and two that were not. And I went to one that was not. I had an opportunity, you might say, to motivate them and take them on long runs. In the desert, we went to sand dunes and things like that. But I think what is most interesting is the logistics part of that. Many times in my mind, I think the book that General Baconis wrote as far as how they got everything through us or to us during the war. One of my challenges, and I'm grateful for it, is that one of my soldiers, Sergeant First Class Dorsey, was hit, believe it or not, on Pipeline Road. Pipeline Road was a dangerous road with traffic going up and down constantly. He was hit head on. We came back to Fort Bragg, or should I say he was medevaced to Fort Bragg, but he survived the incident. And I recently saw him back in August of last year, where we had a reunion of some of the folks that was part of the 426 and 50th together at a hotel at Fort Bragg, where we still connect with each other. So again, Desert Shield, Desert Storm resonates with me. I keep up with a lot of my soldiers, the combat veterans, send them Christmas cards and whatnot. And I will tell you the tragedy behind all this is when we returned back home, I had one of my soldiers who passed away because again, he got drunk and he just didn't wake up and whatnot. So again, even though I didn't lose any soldiers, I lost one soldier coming back once we got back to Fort Bragg shortly after or whatnot. So I remember Corporal Fuller in my mind. So it's really heart-wrenching just to think about him.